Hustle. Time for us to get right into our King Prize Royal Hustlers for this morning. Tuesdays and Thursdays are dedicated to Namibian Royal Hustlers, those who have started at the bottom, worked their way to the top, and today it can be some of the most influential people we have in the country. For example, this morning my guest is a human rights lawyer, and his hobbies are racing with fast cars, aeroplanes, and engineering, especially of fast cars. I'm talking about Mr. Norman Chombe. Good morning, and thank you very much for joining us.
Good morning, Chair.
It's great to have you here.
Yeah, it's great to be here. I appreciate your invitation.
Thank you very much for accepting.
Well, I grew up in Grootfontein, more specifically in Mulunga, with my grandparents. My grandfather was the school principal of Magalani Primary School, where I also started my school career. Lived in Grootfontein all my life. I went to junior high school in Grootfontein, and then I finished junior high school just before independence. At that time, the high school in Grootfontein was exclusively for white people. And as a result of that, I had to find a school elsewhere, outside Grootfontein, because there was no other high school in Grootfontein. And I came to Windhoek, to Ella Du Plessis, where I finished my high school, and then went to Cape Town for my law studies, and finished it at the University of the Western Cape. Worked at the Legal Assistance Center. I had a scholarship from the Legal Assistance Center. I used to go to their offices when I was in matric, to work as a cleaner there, and to do coffee for them, that sort of thing. And holidays whilst in Cape Town, I would come back, work at the Legal Assistance Center as a paralegal. Started working there as a candidate legal practitioner, qualified, worked as a legal practitioner, became the director, and now I'm on the board.
For making coffee in the offices, becoming the director.
Yeah, I used to clean the boardroom, now I'm on the board.
That's why we have Royal Hustlers.
That was the only career that I always
wow.
wanted. My aptitude test that we did in grade 7, grade 8, indicated that I should become a mechanic, and that maybe explains some of the likings that I had.
Yes.
But I always wanted to be a lawyer.
Wow.
You know, Grootfontein was the military headquarters of the apartheid regime. If there are people outside the war zone where now the former of Ambule and some parts of Kavango and Kaprivi region. Outside those war zones, people in Grootfontein have seen what apartheid is really like. I mean, we were beaten up, we were arrested. You know, your parents would just be picked up at night and you would not see them for 3-4 months. You know, that was brutal.
Yeah.
And I mean, there must have been other reasons also, but
yeah.
I looked at that and I said, look, this injustice must stop.
Yeah.
And my grandfather was one of those very strong nationalists. You know, he believed in the education of the black child. He indoctrinated us with history that were not in the textbooks.
Mm-hmm.
We did the history of Europe and of the Americas and that sort of thing. But we didn't do formally in school the history of Samuel Maharero and the history of Witboy and that sort of thing. And he taught us that. And that sort of, you know, pushed us into that direction to say, look, we need to be more of a resistance to the apartheid regime. And, you know, law was one of those that I believed in.
Yeah.
That, I mean, 1988, there was the national school strikes. Kids were arrested in Grootfontein. My classmates were arrested. We went to attend the court cases, and I looked at it. Anton Lobosky, the late Anton Lobosky, was one of the lawyers. He put up such a sterling performance in court, and I said, "Well,
wow.
One day I'll
That's be gonna
the
be me. That's gonna be me."
Yeah. Every day I'm hustling. I don't think I've achieved what I want to always achieve. You know, there's so much human rights violations in Namibia that I feel personally that as lawyers we have not done much to address these issues. There are quite a number of lawyers dealing with human rights violations, going to courts, educating people, you know, giving them the information to protect themselves against human rights violations. But I believe that we should be doing even much more than that. And that, unfortunately, I mean, I can never say we'll become a successful lawyer if we have this phase of just brutal poverty. I mean, the poverty is a massive assault on the human rights of people. And we continue to have that. And so we can never say that we have achieved what we want to achieve, we are successful in our lives. That's not the aim. I tremendously enjoy my work. Make no mistake about that. There are obviously cases that you win, that you have enormous satisfaction from winning a case. You look at you represented a woman who has been mistreated in a village by the traditional authorities, and you come out victorious. Your client comes out victorious out of that. And that's a personal victory for me, working on a case. It's also a victory for me. You know, I'm a lecturer at the Justice Training Center. We train upcoming lawyers. And every now and then, they come to me and say, Norman, can you do my application for admission? I said, like, wow. You know, and I look at all of the students that I've trained in the last 5-6 years, and they're successful lawyers. They do what they are trained to do, and they do it so well. And I like look at them and I say, I'm very young. You know, I started my career very, you know, just at 22 years old. So my age gap between me and my students is not that big. And I look at them and I say, well, you know, this is great, you know, to have so many lawyers, black women who are in practice, because it's so difficult for black women to remain in private practice for many reasons. I mean, there's you know, the black tax, you know, that women are expected to have children. They must take care of their siblings, they must take care of the grandmother, they must take care of everyone. And they, you know, now they're breastfeeding, they have to run home to go and feed the child, they have to be in court, there's an urgent application out of town, there's all of it. You know, so a lot of black women unfortunately leave the profession. But I think increasingly, I mean, my class, the majority are women, black women, and I look at them and I say, wow, the face of the legal profession is changing, maybe not fast enough, but it's changing. And you know, judges get appointed from the legal profession. We have very, very few female judges, and hopefully in the next 50 years, or maybe 20 years, we will have more female judges and black female judges, because of the legal profession's, the demographics changing quite rapidly. What I appreciate of a lot of clients is that you know, they might not know which section, which article in the Constitution, which section in the statute, what type of law there is harming them. But there's this yearning, this sort of reaching out for human rights. It's like something is wrong, I'm being violated, I want to do something about it. And then they stand up. They stand up. I always say to clients, I live in Windhoek. I practice my trade in court. You go back to that village, you go back to the company where you work, you go back to your community. Are you prepared to take on this challenge? I will stand next to you, we will take it on. But I want to make sure that when I leave and I go on to my next case, I leave you in your village, that you will feel comfortable having challenged your chief, your headman, you know, the elders in the village. And then not in one case have they said, no, I don't want to take the case on. They have taken on. That is so great. That people are assertive. Once they know where to go, what to do, they're so assertive to demonstrate that they would not be abused, they would not be violated. Absolutely. That's absolutely great.
And they're changing their mindset. So
and absolutely. After absolutely. Yes. You know, what I look for in colleagues is integrity. You know, I work with people in my firm, outside, integrity, and unfortunately or fortunately, that is the yardstick that I demand. if you don't have that integrity, how you deal with your clients, how you deal with money of your clients, how you deal with your opponents, that you don't just, you know, work over them and make sure that you win the case at all costs. You know, at the end of the day, that person on the other side of the courtroom is also a human being, and we'll have to deal with it in that way. And that I demand from not only my colleagues, I demand it from everyone that I come into contact with. Well, I think we still have a generation, my generation, you know, the 40-somethings, that were kids at Independence, who have a very, very vivid memory of how it was before Independence, the brutality of the apartheid regime, and immediately, as if you know, like a change from day to night or from night to day, it switched, and at Independence. With a lot of problems, I don't write them off, and that's the reason why I'm still in this type of job. We still have a lot of challenges, but that is not comparable to what we had before Independence.
Yes.
So when we look at the new Namibia, you know, 30 years old Namibia, you look at it and you see, wow, there's so much opportunities. So it's absolutely the most wonderful country to live in. I criticize our political leaders as much as I can do, but I can guarantee you one, that I've traveled, I've worked in other countries. We have the most approachable politicians. You know, you can really call a minister, you can meet the president, you can see the headman, you can see the chief, you can, you know. And by African standards, and unfortunately it is by African standards, we have probably a country with the most open system.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's the, you know, we can criticize our leaders in very robust way, and we don't go to prison for it. You know, in Angola you can't do that, in Zimbabwe you can't do that. You know, Botswana has some problems with that sort of system. You know, much of Africa, speaking, although it may be, it's a freedom of expression, there's no guarantee of freedom after speaking.
After speaking, yeah.
You know, and that's sad. But in Namibia, the newspapers are fairly free to publish what they want. I would have thought that they should be a little bit more robust than they are, you know, the radios, the other media. But if you look at, for instance, in social media, how young people contribute to the political debates, and sometimes you get irritated by the sort of line of argument that the person takes. But I mean, then again, we must realize we don't have a monopoly over the type of arguments, the line of thought that the person takes, and that's actually what we should be allowing.
Mm.
We should allow open speech. There's a free market of ideas, that you go to the market and you debate it, and you take whatever the best argument, you take it with
you.
Like you would go to a market and buy potatoes, you choose which potato is the best, and you pick that one.
Yeah.
And that's the sort of openness and the opportunities that this country presents. There's such a lot of vibrant young people. Given the opportunity, they will excel this country.
Absolutely.
I tell you.
Absolutely.
You can just see that when you have a conversation with young people at the school, at the university, in my class, you will see that we are not lacking in people who love this country and want to make this country a great place.
So that must mean that we are excited then
absolutely.
The country for the next 5 to 10 years?
No, for the next 100 years.
100 years.
You know, because remember this generation, say of the 15-year-olds, so that they have a lifespan of another 75 years.
Yep.
So, you know, and another group are being born every day.
Mm-hmm.
That would, you know, so we have quite a good decade and more, up to a century, that we would have to we can only do good.
Absolutely. Mr. Chombe, thank you very much. For the other human rights lawyers that we can talk to on a day-to-day, even on social media in the media, that you have opened up your doors and you have opened up your doors to not only those that you want to, but to those in the land of the brave all over every single corner. And we want to see just more of men like you in our communities and women that can bring some of what you have given just to our tables and open the doors for us. So thank you very much for your work and thank you very much.
It's a pleasure.
For staying true to us.
It's a pleasure.
There you have it for your Royal Hustlers. In case you just got that last bit, we were talking to human rights lawyer, Mr. Norman Chombe, who, by the way, is very vocal on social media. Follow him there as well if you just want to hear anything that he has to mention. But head on over to our social media platforms and catch this interview live and live. It's a wrap of our Royal Hustlers. Let's get right back into the music. This time around, Jay-Z's Rock Boys is in the building.